Greetings. I have to say, in all humbling humility, I believe Yahweh led me to make this video. It started in one direction, then went in a significantly deeper direction than I had envisioned. But in the end, I believe the Lord confirmed this was the direction He led. Sometimes reading comments under videos, there seem obvious posts which need to be made. Greetings, brother. Do you find it easier to accept a deity that your own mind can define? If you think about it, an Allah that a man's mind can conceive is no more than a man's thoughts, but a God that is actually beyond human understanding could only be known by what He reveals about Himself. That, of course, was treated to a respectful response. Okay, brother, if Trinity is beyond understanding, and if it's true, then it's God's responsibility to protect the Holy Bible against contradictions and corruption. Why there are more than 140 versions of Bible and which one is true? What caught my eye is the implication of this statement. It's God's responsibility to protect the Holy Bible against contradictions and corruption. I think preservation of His Word is clearly the responsibility of God. If God cannot do this much, He is no God at all. And there are two situations which must be understood. First, Islam claims its Allah is the deity who authored the Torah and Injil. And it claims the Torah has been changed, and the Injil has been changed so much it virtually no longer exists. But as I stated, if Allah cannot preserve His Word, He is not God. He is impotent. So if you believe Islam's claim the Torah and Injil are corrupted, Allah cannot be a God worthy of being followed or even feared. Second, Yahweh God said He would watch over His Word. The Jewish and Christian assertion is that the Torah and Bible are accurately preserved. The only people who assert wholesale corruption or loss of message are Muslims with an agenda. So Yahweh God has preserved His Word, which we should reasonably require of any deity worthy of worship. But that only addresses half of the poster's assumption. It's God's responsibility to protect the Holy Bible against corruption. It is quite clear God has done just that. There is no corruption in His message. But what about contradictions? And this is really a fascinating topic to critically examine. What constitutes a legitimate, critical contradiction in the Word of God? The answer to that ostensibly boils down to understanding the difference between inspiration and transcription. Islam, in order to appear more certain and believable, has claimed that Allah Himself wrote the Quran. No, more like dictated the Quran. Well, really, somehow originated the Quran. Oops, really, they now claim the Quran is eternal, and therefore always existed. But that claim does not hold logical water. First, if the Quran is eternal, it is co-equal with Allah Himself. If Allah spoke it into existence, the Quran is not eternal. The Quran did not exist before Allah spoke it. Second, the Quran itself establishes the doctrine of abrogation. This means Allah not only can, but may change any part of the Quran at any time. And Allah making changes so as not to upset Muslims will change their memory of what the Quran once was. Surah 2:106. Any revelation we cause to be superseded or forgotten, we replace with something better or similar. Do you not know that Allah has power over everything? But that begs a very troubling question for Islam. Which version of the Quran is eternal? The existence of the doctrine of abrogation means neither could be eternal. The Quran, which existed before the act of abrogation by Allah, no longer exists. The Quran, which exists after the act of abrogation by Allah, did not exist before the act. So the Quran itself creates a damning refutation of the concept of an eternal Quran. The Bible, on the other hand, asserts the message of the prophets is inspired. To me, that means Yahweh God had a general concept he wished to communicate, but did not dictate the message character by character. There are cases where a prophet introduces his message with the word of the Lord. Hosea 4:1, listen to the word of the Lord, O sons of Israel, for the Lord has a case against the inhabitants of the land, because there is no faithfulness or kindness or knowledge of God in the land. Ezekiel 32:1, in the 12th year, in the 12th month, on the first of the month, the word of the Lord came to me, saying, 1 Kings 18:1, and it came to pass after many days that the word of the Lord came to Elijah in the third year, saying, go, show yourself unto Ahab, and I will send rain upon the earth. Jeremiah 1:2, to whom the word of the Lord came in the days of Josiah the son of Amon, king of Judah, in the 13th year of his reign. In these situations, it obviously indicates that there is a specific message God revealed to the prophet. But all the surrounding text outside the quotes may have been allowed, inspired description by the prophets. That is easily the case because these words may not necessarily change God's message or meaning. Would it make a difference to a non-quoted passage if it added, and he got a rock in his shoe on the road and removed it? Probably not, or it would have been added because it needed to be added. There are cases where a prophet introduces his message with, thus says the Lord of hosts. Zechariah 1:3, therefore say unto them, thus says Yahweh, the Lord of hosts, return to me, declares the Lord of hosts, that I may return to you, says the Lord of hosts. Such a phrase indicates an exact message which Yahweh God clearly specified. Jeremiah 7:21, thus says Yahweh, the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, add your burnt offerings to your sacrifices and eat flesh. Clearly, such direct attributions reflect a specific integrity of communication from God to the prophet. It is as if the prophet heard the voice of Yahweh God either in his ears or in his heart. And this too is absolutely foreign to the mechanisms Islam dares to speculate. The account or fable of Muhammad receiving the Quran is from Jibril reading to him from a whole copy of the Quran. At least this is the method claimed when Islam wishes to claim Isaiah 29:12 is a description of Muhammad receiving the Quran as an unlearned man who cannot read a book handed to him. Not so with Yahweh God, who demonstrates over and over that his voice can be heard. Exodus 20:22. Then the Lord said to Moses, "Thus shall you say to the sons of Israel, you yourselves have seen that I have spoken to you from heaven." Deuteronomy 4:36. Out of the heavens he let you hear his voice to discipline you, and on earth he let you see his great fire, and you heard his words from the midst of the fire. Nehemiah 9:13. Then you came down on Mount Sinai and spoke with them from heaven. You gave them just ordinances and true laws, good statutes and commandments. So God spoke audibly, where the whole people of Israel could hear his voice. And this actually troubled Israel, so that they desired to not hear his voice. Exodus 20:19. Then they said to Moses, "Speak to us yourself, and we will listen, but let not God speak to us, or we will die." So the biblical record of how God communicates includes direct, audible messages, both in the Old and then the New Testaments. Matthew 17:5, while Peter was still speaking, a bright cloud enveloped them, and a voice from the cloud said, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Listen to him." Mark 9:7, then a cloud appeared and enveloped them, and a voice came from the cloud, "This is my beloved Son, listen to him." 2 Peter 1:17, for he received honor and glory from God the Father when the voice from the majestic glory said to him, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." And we ourselves heard this voice from heaven when we were with him on the holy mountain. So, without a doubt, God can directly, audibly communicate a clear message if he so desires. And that specific quoted text is directly God's specific words. But there is at least one example which carries a subtle implication we must be aware of. 1 Samuel 3:19. Samuel grew, and Yahweh, the Lord, was with him, and he fulfilled everything Samuel prophesied. That has a very subtle implication which could have been clarified. It could have said, "And Samuel perfectly heard and prophesied the word of the Lord." But it did not describe Samuel in those terms. And some translations reflect this subtlety. King James. "And Samuel grew, and the Lord was with him, and did let none of his words fall to the ground." Do you see the subtle implication of that message? Let me first give you the Texas paraphrase of what we imagine it says. "And Samuel grew, and the Lord was with him, and did not let the word of the Lord spoken through Samuel fall to the ground." That is certainly the way my mind wants to embellish the text, to absolutely clarify that Samuel spoke only God's words. But that is not the implication of the King James translation. "And Samuel grew, and the Lord was with him, and did let none of his words," Samuel's words, "fall to the ground." For better or worse, this says his words, meaning Samuel's words. And that implies something I've never heard taught in a church. That in some cases, God obligated himself to fulfill what the prophet said. Perhaps, even if the prophet misheard or misdelivered the message God intended. Heretic! Texas, you're a heretic! I hear you. In fact, I've meditated on this concept and its implications for years. And this is not idle ruminating or careless cogitating. First of all, God knows the end from the beginning. So if God ever had an inner dialogue like the following, it would not surprise me. If I say this to the prophet, he'll hear that and repeat it as the other. We cannot humanly grasp and prove exactly how Yahweh God knows the future with certainty. All we can do is accept God's revelation of himself that he does. And still God, as God, is able to foretell his plan and then execute his plan. Please hang with this poor heretic for one moment longer. Is it possible, therefore, that God's message, delivered by inspiration, is robust against incidental imperfections in delivery? Well, if you really believe in an all-powerful and all-knowing God, I would say, you bet. Because there is one other pair of passages which has infused my meditation on this topic. Hebrews 10:5. Therefore, when he comes into the world, he says, "Sacrifice and offering you have not desired, but a body you have prepared for me." Seems reasonable enough. God prepared or created a body for Jesus' eternal spirit to indwell. If you notice the all caps quotation, that generally means a direct quote of an Old Testament prophet. Are you sitting down? I was a bit shocked the first time I looked this up. Psalm 40, verse 6, "Sacrifice and meal offering you have not desired. My ears you have opened. Burnt offering and sin offering you have not required." Beep, beep, back up the truck. "But a body you have prepared for me. My ears you have opened?" I imagine you just went, "Huh?" like I did the first time I compared this. And yet there are certain facts we can know to help us harmonize this. The Apostle Paul was a Hebrew scholar and Pharisee. I have no doubt he had studied and read the Messianic Scriptures before his salvation and calling. But Paul had something even Prophet David did not have. The Apostle Paul, like every Christian, has the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, living inside us, and in the rarest of rare circumstances, when an Old Testament prophet might not have had perfect hearing, the Holy Spirit, who Jesus promised would teach us all things, just might reveal the truth about what God wanted an Old Testament prophet to have revealed. John 16:12, "I have many more things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. But when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all the truth. For he will not speak of his own initiative, but whatever he hears, he will speak, and he will disclose to you what is to come." Heresy! Texas, you're a heretic! I'm right there with you, brother. Feeling about like Prophet David revealing something he could not fully accept. And what exactly am I referring to with that remark? Psalm 2, in which David, a hardcore monotheist, is told by God to reveal God's Son. Psalm 2:7, I will declare the decree the Lord has said unto me, Thou art my Son, this day have I begotten thee. New American Standard Translation. I will surely tell of the decree of the Lord. He said to me, You are my Son, today I have begotten you. International Standard Version. Let me announce the decree of the Lord that he told me, You are my Son, today I have become your Father. Can you hear the difference in tone in which that is delivered? Not quite the typical, and the word of the Lord came to me. I hear an uncertainty mixed with a determination, like, I'm going to do this thing. I will declare the decree. I will surely tell of the decree of the Lord. Let me announce the decree of the Lord. Let me, as if to say, let me finish before you stone me. But is this any more than the heretical ramblings of a man after too much good barbecue? What scripture do I have that this is even a legitimate course of consideration or cogitation? You've already heard the first evidence, so let's consider the implication. I have many more things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. Jesus said his closest companions, his friends, could not yet bear to hear the whole truth. Was that because the disciples, and just the disciples, were slow and stupid? Or was it because the human capacity to perceive the truth was universally limited to human ability? By that, I mean, did the prophets have any superhuman ability that allowed them to hear God? I believe the scriptural answer would be no. The prophets only had God's knowledge and power on them when the Holy Spirit descended on them. So the coming of the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, to live in every believer would elevate their communion and communication with God. Above that of every last Old Testament prophet, save Yahweh come in the flesh as a prophet. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for speaking to my heart, Lord. Thank you for confirming this is from you. Matthew 11:11. Truly I tell you, among those born of women, there has risen no one greater than John the Baptist. Yet even the least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. There is no prophet greater than John, but the least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than John. And who is in the kingdom of heaven? Christians who are born again. John 3:3, Jesus answered and said to him, Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. And what possibly makes Christians who are born again greater than John and all the prophets? Nothing that we bring to the table, and everything Yahweh God has given us. Greater is he who is in me than he who is in the world. Matthew 11:11. Truly I tell you, among those born of women, there has risen no one greater than John the Baptist. Yet even the least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. And how did God confirm this was what he desired me to share? He nudged me, led me to the context. Matthew 11:10. This is the one about whom it is written, "Behold, I send my messenger ahead of you, who will prepare your way before you." Malachi 3:1, "Behold, I am going to send my messenger, and he will clear the way before me, and the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to his temple, the messenger of the covenant in whom you delight. Behold, he is coming, says the Lord of hosts." Jesus confirms John is the messenger who will announce Yahweh in the earth come to his temple. If you have listened to my description of Malachi, Isaiah, and John proving Jesus is Yahweh, you might have noticed I lacked a specific confirmation by Jesus. This is it. This is the one about whom it is written, "Behold, I send my messenger ahead of you, who will prepare your way before you." Thank you, Lord. Thank you for your Holy Spirit, who leads us into all truth. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.